One of the most influential and key figures to appear throughout the entirety of Greek mythology is the goddess Athena, but she also happens to be one of its most controversial deities, because at times she can appear as two entirely different people, both the villain and the hero of certain stories. Athena was regarded as the goddess of numerous things, including wisdom, justice, strength, strategic warfare, and any skill ranging from artistic to craft. She was of course particularly known for two of these things, her strategic skill in warfare and her wisdom. And it's because of this association you'd be hard-pressed to find any iconic or popular Greek stories that she doesn't in some way feature in. Athena's vast popularity meant that her cults were widespread, and often involved celebrating practices such as weaving, metalwork, and philosophy. The largest of these cults was of course located in Athens, not only because of the importance of the city, but because that is where many people consider the name Athena to have come from in the first place. The ancient Greeks would sometimes refer to Athena as Palaisigma, or even as Pallas Athena. The origins of the word Pallas are still fairly ambiguous. Some would argue that it was used to describe a young woman, whereas others believed it was something more combative, meaning to brandish a weapon. When the people of Athens called her Pallas Athena, this could be interpreted as them referring to her as young Athena, or even as Athena the protector. The exact meaning of the word is something that we can only really speculate about, but there is the alternative belief that Pallas was an entirely separate entity slain by Athena. In ancient Greece, Pallas was a fairly common name to see, so it does make numerous appearances in several different stories as a handful of different people. In one interpretation, Pallas was a giant slain by Athena, who then flayed his skin as a trophy, wearing it as a cloak, an ever-present reminder of her victory. In another version, Pallas was Athena's father, whom she killed when he attempted to assault her. Athena once again took his skin as a trophy, so there is a pattern forming in terms of taking a kill and turning it into a trophy, something to be proud of, and that is something you would expect from a warrior or a hunter of that given time. There is a version of this story, however, that paints Athena in a far more positive manner. In this story, Pallas was a childhood friend of Athena who was accidentally slain during a sparring match between the two. Athena, of course distraught and deeply saddened by the loss of a close friend, took the name Pallas as a sign of respect and honour. By doing this, Athena ensured that the name Pallas would never be forgotten, and neither would her fallen friend. The Romans of course referred to Athena by a very different name. She was associated with the goddess Minerva, who many considered to be the Etruscan or the Roman counterpart to the Greek Athena. We begin exploring the many stories of Athena with how she was born, and the rather odd circumstances surrounding the entire situation. So as many of you may already know, Athena is largely regarded as the daughter of Zeus, but her mother isn't something that we hear about too often. Athena's mother was the goddess known as Metis, a second generation Titan that many associated with wisdom and craft, traits that she certainly passed down to her daughter. Metis was also considered to be the first real lover and spouse of Zeus, but as soon as they laid together, the same prophecy that haunted his father began to take hold of Zeus. Uranus was overthrown by his son Cronus and the rest of his children. Cronus was then told by his father that the same thing would happen to him, and so he swallowed his children to prevent this. But eventually Zeus and the Olympians overthrew Cronus, causing history to repeat itself once again. Uranus and Gaia then prophesied that Metis would bear Zeus children stronger and wiser than even himself, implying that they could one day possibly overthrow him, like he had previously done to his own father. To stop this from happening, Zeus took a page out of his own father's book, swallowing Metis whole, but she had already conceived his child. We don't really hear much of Metis after this point onwards, so I think it's safe to assume that she died sometime in between being swallowed alive by Zeus and given birth to Athena. Zeus, however, began to experience excruciating headaches, with no reason or explanation as to why. When the other gods and goddesses examined Zeus, they came to the conclusion that there may be something trapped inside. They would then take an axe and cleave Zeus's head open to see what was inside. And from this gaping split emerged Athena, fully grown and covered in armour from head to toe. The other gods were left speechless, admiring the goddess that had stood before them. Historians and poets over the years have made numerous claims as to who Athena's father could have been, but Zeus still remains the most common answer of them all. There was, however, the notion that Athena was the first goddess to be conceived not from intercourse, but through presence of mind and thought. This idea of Zeus being the sole parent who conceived Athena did create some tension between himself and his wife Hera. This led to Hera attempting the same thing, but it ultimately resulted in her giving birth to the misshapen and deformed Hephaestus. There are some accounts where Hephaestus was born long before Athena, and he was actually one of the gods responsible for opening Zeus's head and freeing Athena. So this definitely can get a bit confusing, considering that all through Greek mythology there are several timelines that inherently contradict and clash with each other. But that's not to say that either one of these stories is incorrect, more so that they were told at a different time in a different region. Whilst we are still on the topic of Athena and Hephaestus, there is one story that some of you may find either quite disturbing or rather amusing. When the marriage between Aphrodite and Hephaestus had ended, he began to pursue Athena and make numerous advances that she would easily palm away. One day during his routinely rejection, Hephaestus got so excited during what I can only assume was Athena wrestling him away, that he ejaculated on her thigh. Athena, of course, disgusted and annoyed, wiped it off onto the ground, which of course wasn't really the ground, it was Gaia, who then fell pregnant and gave birth to the half-serpent, half-man, known as Erectonius, who would later become one of the great kings of Athens. If you are someone who's wondered why Athena's children are never mentioned, that's because they never existed. Athena remained what many would consider a virgin goddess, but there are some accounts where she took pity on Erectonius because of the way he looked, adopting him and raising him as her own son. So to summarize the entire story, Hephaestus tried to have sex with his sister slash stepsister, but ended up impregnating his great-grandmother who gave birth to a snake boy, which was then raised by the sister he tried to have sex with initially. I'd say that sounds pretty weird, but it just sounds like a regular day in mythology. One of the most iconic stories featuring Athena involved the naming of Athens and how she became its patron. The city that became Athens was founded by a half-man, half-snake creature, Cecrops, who would eventually become the king and name the city after himself, Cecropia. Under his reign, the city prospered greatly and was described as being so beautiful that it was the worthy home of a god. When the gods of Olympus saw this city, they argued over who would claim this territory. The last two to settle this argument were of course Athena and her bitter rival Poseidon, who were both adamant that the patronage of the city should be an honour bestowed upon them. In order to solve this dispute, Zeus decided that both Athena and Poseidon would give a gift to the king and his people, and they would in turn decide who would be the patron. Poseidon was first to present his gift to the king and his people. He took his trident and he slammed it down onto a boulder, creating a spring, from which emerged enough water that the people would never have to worry about drought again. At first, Poseidon's gift seemed like it couldn't be matched by anything, but then the people realized that it was actually seawater, and it was essentially useless. Witnessing the failure of Poseidon, Athena then planted a single seed, which would grow into an olive tree. This gift was overwhelmingly received by the people of Cecropia, not just because it provided them with food, oil, and firewood, but also because the olive branch was a symbol of peace and stability. With the gifts now received, the people of Cecropia had to choose between the two deities, but considering the two gifts that they were given, and the overall practicality, Athena was chosen without hesitation, and thus the city's name was changed to Athens to honour its new patron. The sacred animal of Athens was then changed to an owl, and it would appear on both sides of coins as a symbol of wisdom and their new patron. Olive trees would then be planted all around the city, to replicate the gift that was given to them and to encourage peace and prosperity. Now that's not to say with Athena as their new patron, the people of Athens didn't encounter any problems, because they certainly did. Poseidon's gift may not have turned out the way he would have liked, but it's very clear that he identified a problem that Athens would face in the future, and drought was something that did plague Athens during the summer, but it does raise a few interesting questions as to what Poseidon could have done as a patron and what he would have named the city. In the years that followed, it became pretty common for scholars to argue as to which came first, whether Athena was named after the city or if the city was named after Athena. For the most part, they did come to the agreement that it was actually Athena who was named after the city. It is very difficult to find a story of an iconic Greek hero that doesn't involve Athena in some way offering her guidance and counsel, which is why to many she was considered the hero's patron. Normally in the hero's journey they come across a problem that they cannot overcome, and this is often when we see Athena manifest and essentially save the day. In the stories of Perseus and Heracles, she appears to ensure that they are adequately equipped for their perilous adventures. When Perseus was tasked with retrieving the head of Medusa, he was given various weapons and equipment to aid him. But it was Athena who gave him the bronze polished shield that he could use as a mirror, making it so he could gaze upon Medusa without being turned to stone. When Bellerophon embarked on his journey to kill the Chimera, he first travelled to Athena's temple for counsel. Here Athena gave him a golden bridle, allowing him to tame Pegasus and completely change the dynamic of the entire battle. The most famous example of Athena as a patron and guide to heroes is Heracles, or Hercules depending on which interpretation you're most familiar with. Like Perseus, Heracles was a half-brother to Athena, but there's no doubt that she took a larger interest in this particular son of Zeus, from protecting and helping raise him as a child, to ensuring that he was able to complete his 12 labours and earn his redemption. Over the years, Athena watched over Heracles, sometimes passively observing, and other times intervening when she felt assistance was needed. When Heracles needed to collect the golden apples from the Garden of the Hesperides, in some versions he had the Titan Atlas collect them for him, and in exchange he would assume the Titan's responsibilities in holding up the sky. Now, as strong as Heracles was, this was even beyond his capabilities. Athena would then intervene, assisting him in hoisting up the sky until the Titans return. We do see Athena intervene once again when Heracles faced the Hydra, this time giving him a golden sword that he would use to cut off the Hydra's last immortal head. For the majority of Heracles' labours, Athena is very much a spectator, acknowledging her brother's desire to complete these labours alone to earn his redemption. But she does of course intervene on numerous occasions. if we consider the fact that his labours are constantly being stacked against him by Hera and King Eurystheus, then Athena is essentially the great equaliser to Heracles' story. There is another rather well-known hero that Athena offered her guidance to, this time appearing in the work of Homer, where she guides Odysseus home and assists him in retaking his kingdom. This scenario is definitely slightly different to that of Heracles, where Athena assumes the role of the older protective sister, and it's quite clear to us that she's driven by emotion and the duty to protect her brother. Odysseus instead had to win the favour of Athena, which he did through his tact and guile. Athena would appear to Odysseus on his journey home by entering his thoughts and guiding him, and then once again in person when back in Ithaca. So if you happened to be a hero back in ancient Greece who needed assistance, the best thing you could do was earn the favour of Athena. So now on to what I think is the most interesting point of discussion, the duality of Athena, the hero and the villain. Athena is a goddess that quite often people either hate or love, and that's because she's presented in two very different ways with two very different personalities. Most of this can be attributed to and explained by two very popular stories, the story of Arachne and the story of Medusa. These are both stories that I have covered before numerous times on the channel, but what they seem to have in common is a theme of punishment, or what many consider the unjust punishment of an undeserving individual. I think what is lost on most people, or what they just choose to ignore, is that these stories have numerous interpretations. The Athena that you see in one story may not be the same goddess held in such high regard by the ancient Greek people. It may in fact be the interpretation of the Roman poet Ovid. This is a very important detail to consider, because in both Ovid's versions of Medusa and Arachne, Athena is extremely unsympathetic and heavily driven by emotion, jealousy and anger, not exactly the pragmatic, calm and wise goddess the ancient Greeks believed her to be. Medusa is punished for being raped in Athena's temple, and Arachne for besting Athena in a weaving contest, and my issue with these stories is just they're too out of character for Athena. We've established earlier that she can be driven by emotion, in relation to the story of Heracles, but the depiction given by Ovid is just that of a bitter, jealous and irrational woman, who's extremely unlikable, and honestly may as well be the villain of these stories. To the ancient Greeks, Athena was a fair, just and wise protector. In Arachne's story, when she completes her tapestry, it's actually Zeus who punishes her, and not Athena. With Arachne now disgraced and not able to weave, she attempts to commit suicide, but Athena takes pity upon her, transforming her into the first spider, where in the form of spiderwebs, she can weave beautiful patterns just like she did with her tapestries. The difference in these two stories is night and day. In Ovid's interpretation, Athena is so angry that she loses the weaving contest that she beats Arachne before transforming her into a spider. In the more traditional Greek versions, Arachne is punished by Zeus for her hubris. It's then Athena who picks up the pieces and attempts to help Arachne the best she can. The story of Medusa also does follow a similar trend. In Ovid's version, Medusa is raped and then turned into a gorgon as a way to punish her. In the more traditional Greek interpretations, when Medusa is raped by Poseidon, Athena transforms her into a gorgon so she can protect herself and ensure that it never happens again. In the versions where Medusa has sex with Poseidon in Athena's temple out of personal gain or spite, Athena's punishment makes a lot more sense and it's a lot easier to justify. So that's a dilemma that most people find themselves faced with. When you hear stories of Athena as the goddess of wisdom and a great protector to the ancient Greek people, and then you hear the interpretations of Ovid, it creates a disconnect because what you're essentially seeing is two different characters. You can also make the claim that Ovid's story shows Minerva and not Athena, but it's a distinction that many people are confused by. So I guess the easiest way to summarize what I've just said is if you see a story of Athena where she's acting out of jealousy, spite, or just being an overall dick to people, then it's probably one of Ovid's Roman interpretations. If the story paints Athena in a far more caring and rational manner, then it's probably closer to the traditional Greek depictions of her. To the ancient Greeks, Athena was probably the most widely celebrated and valued of all of the female deities, serving as patron to many of the Greek cities, and her origins do stretch all the way back to the Mycenaeans, whose religion is shrouded in mystery, but we do know that Athena appeared as a goddess of protection and household crafting. Athena did suffer somewhat of a character assassination when Greece became Christianized. She went from the virgin goddess who everybody admired, to someone who was condemned as immodest and immoral. The Greeks did however transfer many of these attributes to the Virgin Mary, which is why she was often seen wearing the Gorgonian and appearing as a warrior maiden. Athena is a goddess that I could discuss for several hours, and still there would be depictions and stories that I forget to mention. So I guess this is where I throw it over to you. If you have any thoughts or ideas that you'd like to share about Athena, then please do so in the comments below. If you have enjoyed this video, then please consider leaving a thumbs up or even subscribing and hitting that pesky notification bell, because it really does help the channel to continue to grow. I do also have a Patreon in the description below for anyone who's interested in supporting what I do. As always, I've been your host, Mythology and Fiction Explained.